I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims' pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. My native country thee, land of the noble free, thy name I love. I love thy rocks and rills, thy woods and templed hills. My heart with rapture thrills like that above. And ring from all the trees sweet freedom's song. Let mournful tongues awake, let all that breathe partake, let rocks their silence break, the sound of long. Our fathers, God, to thee, honor of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Begin in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Good morning and God's peace to you all. And welcome to our worship service. Wishing you all happy 4th of July. Our first reading will be from the 145th Psalm. And we'll be reading verses 1 to the end. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, his words say, I want you to know, I will extol thee, my God, O King. I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day will I bless thee, and I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise thy works to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty, and of thy wondrous works. And men shall speak of the might of thy terrible acts. And I will declare thy greatness. They will abundantly utter the memory of thy great goodness, and shall sing of thy righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and of great mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All thy works shall praise thee, O Lord, and thy saints shall bless thee. They shall speak of the glory of thy kingdom, and talk of thy power, to make known to the sons of men his mighty acts, and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and thy dominion endureth throughout all generations. The Lord upholdeth all that fall, and raiseth up all those that be bowed down. The eyes of all who wait upon thee, and thou givest them their meat in due season. Thou openest thine hand and satisfiest the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and holy in all his works. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, and to all that call upon him in truth. I will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He will also hear their cry and will save them. The Lord, he preserveth all of them that love him. But all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. And let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen.
Lord, by thy name, morning. Wow. Good morning. A few extra faces. It's always so surprising when I come up here and turn around and see who snuck in late. Nate, you didn't want to do the prayer, so that's why you snuck in late. All right. Anybody remember a couple weeks ago when I first came up here? What I asked or what I said? I am forgiven. And we are forgiven. And then from there, my thoughts for the next few weeks went to, some of these are coming from that wonderful list that Cheryl, about a year or two ago, that had given Orville, you know. And being we are forgiven, now I am righteous. Isn't that a wonderful thought? I am righteous and acceptable to God. Let us pray. Dear Father, we come before you this morning just thanking and praising you for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your love, your understanding, your compassion, all those wonderful things, the way that you look at us through the blood of your Son. We just thank you for that. We just also today just pray that you'd be with Pastor Bob, that you would give him an open heart to hear from you and to be able to proclaim your message today. We just also want to thank you for the healings, for taking care of us, for watching over us, and being it is our nation's celebration for independence, we thank you for the blessings that you've bestowed upon our nation, and just really ask that you would cause a revival in our nation so that you would could continue to bless us, that we as a nation would once again stand up and proclaim that you are the one and only God that we kneel to. So we just ask for that revival in our nation today. And we just now ask that you would all join me in that wonderful prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And dear Lord, just continue to bless our offering today. Our plate is in the back there again. And give us the wisdom to use your gifts to increase the knowledge of you, even in this community. In Jesus' name, amen. And I didn't read the scripture, right? Nobody caught that? I didn't see people waving, hey, you forgot the scripture. It's here somewhere, Bob said. Matthew. I can read it like this. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Lord, or O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight, all things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. In Jesus' name, amen.
May the grace, mercy, and peace of God, our Heavenly Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be multiplied unto each one of us now and forever. I was a little bit surprised that Jesus Savior pilot me, one of my all-time favorites. Now, there's so many beautiful hymns to pick a favorite, it would be extremely hard. But to think of Jesus, my Savior, piloting me, him being that light on the shore, no matter how rough the sea gets, no matter how difficult our life seems, he is that pilot. And for that, I'm extremely thankful. And that our text this morning is found in the book of Romans. It's somewhat a continuation of last week. Last week, we opened a little can of worms when we talked about this thing called sin. And I'm not very good at challenges, and I didn't challenge anybody last week. But if I had challenged, my challenge would have been find a sin in your life and make change in your life. Because that is one thing that our Lord does do. He does pilot. He does lead. Some of those things do come up in our lives. And today is going to be, a continuation of that thought. Now we, as believers, have recognized, if you will, that sin is still bad. Sin still comes between us and Christ. And now, our continuing question is, now what? We have come to believe. We've recognized that we cannot have faith in and of ourselves. That is not possible. It is simply through him. But yet we still live. Sin is still in the world. Now let's continue. Now we're going to go to our text in Romans chapter 7, verses 13 through chapter 8, verse 2. Reading in the name of our Lord. Was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For that what I would, that do I not, but what I hate, that I do. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that is good. Now then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity, into the law of sin which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Amen. A better tongue twister would be hard to find than the one we just read. And I think it's important that we recognize that in this moment, and I think we mentioned it a couple weeks ago, that this is It's a pivotal moment in Paul's letter to the Romans, as it is in our life. And we need to remember that this is part of a long letter. And I'm going to say once again that Paul is, if a letter were a speech, he would be pounding his fist. That which I do, I would not. That which I would not, that I do. That's what he would be doing. We need to remember he was animated. I mean, it just, the only word that comes to mind is reeks of it. It's such a strong message. He had just talked about, and earlier in the chapter he talks about divorce and remarriage, and how that strong, and how, if you will, that marriage bond is something that is so strong. And that is why Paul is so worked up. Because that bond is strong, no matter how you look at it. Whether physical or literal, physical, literal, or spiritual. And I believe the spiritual is what is shouting to me, especially now in this passage, as an analogy. Okay? He is talking about splitting this union, and what has happened in our lives as believers. I've left the way of death and sin. That is where we are at. And this message, most of Romans, I would say, the early part is a message that you can certainly say to an unbeliever, because it brings you to Christ. This portion, a believer doesn't get it. It doesn't make sense to an unbeliever. Why? Because he does not recognize sin. An unbeliever has no recognition of sin. Why? Because there is no pilot. There is no guide. To someone that is, and I think we talked about it last week, if I were my own guide, I come up against something and I turn. I don't have to worry about going where I'm being led. So to an unbeliever, the word sin means, I'm going to say, basically nothing. Basically nothing. Sin is something for us. That's what laws are only good for those who follow the laws. If they mean something, we follow them. How many of us speed? And last week we raised our hand for a few different things. How many of us do things that are not within the law? I'm sorry, every one of us, and every one of us continues to do this. That's where Paul is at here. That which I do, I do not. This is something that we go on and on and on and over and over and over. This text reminds me. Now, why would we change? Last week we talked about what sin is and how it's bad for us. Why would we change? And last week, like I said, if I had been smart enough, I would have challenged you to change something. And I'm going to attest that change is not easy. It can happen. There are those of us, I used to swear a fair amount. My mouth was not the cleanest of mouths, especially in later high school, when it was cool. But that is something, praise God, I don't do as much. I'm going to say there are times we are allowed the grace, if you will, to change sins with the little s. We have the ability through Christ to change our actions. That's what Paul is talking about. That's exactly what, there are those things that, you know what, I know this is not the right thing, but yet I'm going to do it. I know I should, if the sign says 55, I should go 55 miles an hour, not 56 or 57. I'm not making adjustments according to my tires are a little different size than they were before, and I'm not going to make an excuse when the officer comes to my window. If I'm going 56, I should pay the ticket, right? That's what Paul is talking about. We have sins in our lives, and you know what? We should take care of them. That's what he's saying. But now my question to you is how much? Each day, and I'm sorry, I wake up in the morning. There's a little prayer that a long time ago I heard it, and it's a cute little thing. Lord, I've been perfect today. I haven't sinned once. I haven't cussed. I haven't swore. I haven't lied, cheated, stolen, or been a glutton. I haven't killed or murdered or robbed anyone, but in a few minutes I'm going to get out of bed and then I'm going to need some help. So how much is enough? That's my question. When have we done enough? James talks about it and I think James does a pretty decent job of showing in James chapter 2. Verses 14 through the end of the chapter. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he have faith and have not works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which he needeth to the body, what doth it profit? Even so faith, if it hath not works, it is dead, being alone. Yea, a man shall say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without what thy works, and I will show thee my work, my faith by my works. Thou believest that there is one God. Thou believest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works? And by works was faith made perfect. And the scripture was fulfilled with which saith, Abraham believed in God and was imputed unto him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works when she had received the messengers and sent them out another way. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Remember that tongue twister I talked about a little while ago? We just had another one. Faith without works is dead and dead. But here he talks about a man named Abraham that we know. And he talks about this man named Abraham that remember that here it talks about him offering his son. Remember Abraham offering his son Isaac. And a beautiful thing was brought to me Friday night by a dear friend of ours and yours. Orville mentioned it. That when Abraham offered his son, it wasn't his first test. You see this up and down, this faith and works and sin and flesh. It's part of a growing process. You don't start with the big ones right off the bat. You start with the little rocks in the field. You get those out and then you work up. And don't forget for a moment that these things are in the power of Christ. Without Christ to guide, none of this that I am talking about makes sense. None of it's even worth talking about because we don't need to do anything if you're not following Christ. If we're not following, we have no need to move whatsoever. This was not Abraham's first rodeo. It started with him leaving home. Then there was many different trials along the way until finally he comes to this point. But remember, but in this James, the last person that's mentioned Likewise also was not Rahab the harlot justified by works, when she received the messengers that sent them out the other way. I hope you remember, but last week we talked about Joshua. And who is this Rahab? Remember our story of Joshua? Last week he sent the spies into the big city of Jericho. He sent the spies. Remember what I talked about? Sometimes those spies, I'm going to say they represent us finding sin in our lives, attacking those sins in our lives, the little things. What can I change in my life? Do you know who they went to see, or who they saw, I should say? A harlot named Rahab. So the spies from Israel go into Jericho in Joshua chapter 2. And as soon as we heard these things, our heart did melt. Neither did there remain any more courage in any man. This is Joshua 2, verse 11 and on. Because of you, for the Lord your God, He was God in heaven above and in earth beneath. Now therefore, I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have showed you kindness, that ye will also show kindness unto my father's house and give me a true token. This is Rahab talking to the spies. She is saying that, please give me a token. I'm helping you. They had come to this harlot, this woman of ill repute in Jericho. She says, I'm going to help you, but I need a sign, that you will save my father and mother and my brethren and my sisters and all that they have and deliver our lives from death. And the men answered her, our life for yours, if ye utter not this our business, and it shall be, when the Lord hath given us the land, we will deal kindly and truly with thee. And when she let them down by a cord through the window, for her house was upon the town wall, and she dwelt upon the wall. And she said unto them, get you to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you, and hide yourselves there 3 days, until the pursuers be returned, and afterward may ye go to your way. And the men said unto her, we shall be blameless of this thine oath, which thou hast made us swear. Let's skip on to verse 21. And she said, according to your words, let it be so. And they went away, and they departed, and she bound the scarlet line by the window. You see, they had given her a scarlet ribbon, a scarlet scarf, a scarlet banner maybe. I'm sure our Lord makes no mistakes. This scarlet is a picture of stained garment, blood stained. Now, I don't know about you, but my mind over the last few minutes that I've been talking about this, it goes round and around and around. And when we start to think about this, when we start to think about what we do, when we start to think about what else can I do in my life, how else can I change my life, how else is God asking me to change my life, there is a never-ending list, and it's over and over and over and over and over again. What else can I change? How can I change my life? What can I do? And I'm not talking about the person sitting next to you. I'm talking about the person looking in my own mirror or holding down my seat. That's who we're talking about now. This argument that Paul is having with himself, that we're going to go back to Romans, this argument that Paul is having with himself about our carnal versus our spiritual, which wins. There's a poem, one of the very few that I've memorized, and it's, I'm going to say it's our my American version. This poem is the Native Americans have a poem very similar. Others have very similar poems. But it goes like this. Two hearts beat within my breast. One is foul and one is blessed. One I love and one I hate. The one I feed will dominate. What Paul is telling us is basically that. What we ought, our mind, our heart ought to be set on Christ. We have these two. We have the flesh and the spirit, and they do battle. This story goes even here. Somebody talks about how long you've been a Christian, and well, since this morning. Since a few minutes ago. The time, I'm going to say, is irrelevant. This battle. The theme that I had for today, if you will, the battle within. This battle continues to rage. And let's get back on that wheel, if you will. Paul is getting frustrated. Paul is saying, getting totally wound up. Good, better, best, never let it rest till the good is better and the better is best. Another little tongue twister. That is our, should be our life, if you will. But my good is okay and it's getting better, but it's better. How do you, Paul gets to the point, as we should, I have to get off this wheel. And that's where the beauty is. Verse 23 of our, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? He came to the end of himself. He came to the very end. This whole, what should I do, what ought I do, what I want to do, I don't do, what I should do, that I don't do. Paul comes to the point just as we ought. Come to the point, even as believers, I would say especially as believers, we must come to the point where I'm not going away from the fact, and that's, I'm not going away from the fact that it is right and just and good to change our lives through the power of Christ. And for the hard thing about a message like this is we get caught in I did. And that's not the point. The point is this, through the power of Christ, these things happen. O wretched man that I am, Paul once again recognizes who he is, just as we recognize who we are. Because remember my challenge that I didn't make last week? For you to change your life in any way? I would be the first to raise my hand to say that I fell short. Because whenever I make a rule for myself, this is just me making a rule for myself, the time is very short before I break my own rules. Before I realize, just like Paul, how wretched I am. I cannot keep my own laws, much less his. Who shall deliver me from this body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. What does he mean by that? He questions, who shall deliver me? Thank you, that Jesus Christ has delivered me. And then he recognizes that in my body, in my personal body, the body of Bob Tumberg, and you can put your name there if you'd like, I'm just talking about me now, my mind and my heart, they will follow Christ. With my mind to the best of my ability, I will follow Christ. That faith that is given to me by Jesus Christ, in his power, I will follow. But in the flesh, these things of the body, they will point me. They will, but with the flesh, the law of sin. This message that I just talked about, this message of I ought to be better, but I just can't do it in and of myself. What that does is that points me to Christ. Remember that battle that we were just in? Yesterday we celebrated the 4th of July. We celebrated Independence Day. Independence Day was brought to us by many brave patriots who lost their lives, who paid a debt for my freedom, that I today can stand here and even talk to you about this man, Jesus Christ. And I choose to talk about this man, Jesus Christ, because I am free to do so. 2,000 years ago, give or take, a man named Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay that sin debt, to pay that debt that I am free from this cycle. That I no longer have to worry about how good I am. Does that change the fact that my life ought to be better than it is? No, it does not. That Paul is once again promising us that it will continue until the grave. It will continue. But I recognize, Paul recognizes, and I also recognize, as you should, that in chapter 8, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. This talking of sin is a hard thing because none of us, and I'm going to say I might be chief of that, none of us like to talk about how bad we are. It's not in our human nature. But the beauty of our shortcomings is so far paled to the beauty of his perfection. And it is because, just as Rahab hung that red ribbon, that red banner outside her window, so when that city of Jericho fell, because it did, one day this earth as we know it will fall. One day Jesus Christ will come again. He will. He promised. So just as Jericho fell, one day our Lord will come again. And my hope and prayer is that each one of us will be holding that banner. That banner of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And because of that, because of Him, this inward battle, as real as it may be, and it is real, it is a battle that we fight. That's why we cannot set some of these things aside. We cannot set aside those things like James talked about, I will show you my faith by my works. It's not how good I am. It's not how great I am. It has nothing to do with that. That's what Paul is saying. And there's umpteen, and that's an argument that we will have until Christ comes again. But Paul is letting us know, just as I am letting you know, that that battle is real. And it will continue. But I, praise God, just as Dan said it before, am righteous through the blood of Christ, because He destroyed this wheel. He has allowed us to follow Him. And that is how and why we are saved. Heavenly Father, we come to You once again this morning. And we praise and thank You because, Lord, first of all, we know that You truly are good. We thank You for the power that You've allowed us, even in our lives. Lord, we pray that You would help us to recognize those things that You would have us set aside, even in our own lives. Because, Lord, we know that the fancy word for this is sanctification. We know that You ask us and You want us to grow in You. Why? Because it's best for us if we set these sins aside. We thank You for piloting us. We thank You for showing us the way. We pray that You would help us to keep on that track. By Your power, by Your might, Your wisdom and Your guidance, we thank You. Lord, there are so many that we do pray for. We do pray for our nation and our world, even as we fight this pandemic and this fear, this, if you will, original sin, that true pandemic. Lord, I pray that You'd be with each body here, that You would allow us to set our minds on You through Your power. And now may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make His face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord lift His countenance upon us and give us His everlasting peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.